Tucker, do you want to? When I was talking to Greg about the space, we should actually do a formal recognition of us actually being inside of S Lab. Oh, okay. And so, Peter, if you would do the honors.
Okay, well, why don't I do a land recognition then while we're at it? That would probably be appropriate rather than instead of a land recognition of S Lab. Let's start with the fact that we're on the traditional territory of many indigenous people back 15,000 years. And this built, you know, Toronto was quite different than the people were gathering then. So if we go back to the Huron-Wendat, the Haudenosaunee, and the Iroquois Confederation. Since then, the Anishinaabe have been the custodians of the land, and the Mississaugas have been in credit, part of the Anishinaabe nation. And so we want to acknowledge their land that this renovated building that we're all on. And so you're in the Strategic Innovation Lab, which is part of the facility here for the Ferocat University's Graduate School. Half of you or more have been here a lot. And so I guess we want to acknowledge the generosity of OCAD in providing this place for systems thinking in these conversations. And for Design with Dialogue, we'll probably mainly be here. So next Design with Dialogue is next week, starting for the first session of this year. So skip January, we'll start Design and Dialogue next Monday. Or that'll be 2 weeks. Dude, I haven't sent out the message yet, so I'm not contradicting anything. So you'll get that later.
Okay. Thanks. And welcome everyone to System Thinking Ontario, now in our sixth year, which seems a little strange. And I was acknowledging over with some people that we started off with is that when we started System Thinking Ontario, it was designed as a circle, and we were meeting over in the Lambert Lounge, and we all, at that point, the rules were discourage PowerPoint and encourage conversation. And so this is probably the first time, actually maybe that last time was more like this. There's been a change in System Thinking Ontario in that I've been working on a project calling the System Changes Research Project. I'll be aligning with the Strategic Innovation Lab here. And as part of that, this is the second presentation trying to bring people up to speed because if we're going to do research together, then we should actually look at some of the stuff that's been happening over the last little while. So I'm running the recorder again. Last time I ran the recorder and bumped it off somehow, and I'll try to keep this on so that we can actually record and people keep track of it. But we'll do the usual System Thinking Ontario thing, which is we usually go around, introduce ourselves, and the question we usually answer is what brought you to System Thinking Ontario or your history or whatever. So, Stephen, would you like to start and talk about where?
Sure. My name is Stephen Rigossi. I'm a systems analyst, worked in industry, and taught systems analysis at Trent University for about 30 years. My current project is a status of the French language in Canada. Nobody has ever looked into the subject, which is kind of unimaginable, but this is what happens. You start with systems thinking and you end up in the oddest corners of what's happening. As a systems analyst, I spend my life looking at systems. The trouble with looking at systems is that you can never see the system. You have to imagine the system. This brilliant overhead right here of David's. Do you see the systems? All right? That's a streetcar track. It's not a train track. Do you see the sewage? Right? Do you see where those rectangular blocks of granite came from? The answer is Ireland. Why? Etc., etc. So because we cannot see systems, we have to imagine them. We can only see patterns. And I guess that's why we are here today. We can't see systems, but we have to see patterns.
Thank you. Kelly?
Hi, I'm Kelly Osamira. I come from Design Intelligence, and I fell into systems, and I'm happy to be here and learn more.
Hi, I'm Emily. SFI program. And so I just learned about this from Peter, who emailed the SFI group. And I'm taking the systems thinking course right now in the program, and happy to learn more.
Well, you get an entirely different lecture from me on the 7th than me, or whichever one. it'll be different.
I'm Curtis, I'm a graduate student at the University of Toronto, the Faculty of Information. I use systems thinking, in particular critical systems thinking, soft systems thinking, critical systems heuristics, as a kind of multi-methodological framework for interventionary or action research, much of which is proposed, some of which is ongoing, none of which is published.
I am Lorraine Randall. I work at OCAD UCO, which is the kind of executive education arm of OCAD. And I am also a grad of SFI. My thesis advisor. I'm really super interested in how education systems work, and now that has kind of led me to a place of wondering about how we make thoughts and new thoughts and sort of big questions.
Since you're here, let me add that the systems change leaders from Forum for the Future are meeting with your secondary advisor, Pavel Lucha in Moscow this week.
Oh,
they were
cool.
Going there anyway. They were looking for people in Moscow, Russia, that were involved in system change. And he's already there and just made that connection. So Lorraine's got an international network. And it's called Global Education Futures.
Yes.
She collaborated with Pavel. You might know from PURPLSOC. Anyway, keep going. I'll go last.
I'm Melissa. I'm a graduate of the SFI program. Started coming to this group while I was at OCAD, and I started coming back about a year ago just because I like it. I work in commercial real estate now, so I was really interested for this topic because I've always been sort of fascinated with the different groups that come together to manifest the built environment and all the systems that are at play in that world. So I'm excited for the talk tonight.
I'm Kurosh Habi, I'm an architect at Diamond & Schmidt. I'm here on the advice of Melissa. But I know about this private time.
Hello, I'm Stephen. I'm actually kind of interested in this idea of systems as like kind of systems that have got some sort of form to them. So this idea of non-linear systems which are kind of not so defined but have still presence in our kind of daily interactions. So it'd be interesting how those two can be reconciled somehow.
Hi, I'm Alana, and my consulting practice is spreading the joys of complexity and strategizing for change. And I just finished my SFI master's here, and I'll be presenting on the thesis part of it next month, my master's research project.
I'm Susanna Leonard, and I come from a background more in the cybernetics end. And the latest project seems to be to try and design a viable system model of the government of a small country.
How small?
Quite small.
Can you say, or would you have to kill us?
I shouldn't say yet, not until the funding goes in.
No.
My name is Robert Best. I came here through, I'd say, social media curation, and following my curiosity in peer-to-peer technology and decentralized web tech. So I met David at a meetup just last Friday, and he mentioned about this session. And, I actually recently had been working in sort of peer-to-peer crypto space for a project called Polychain. Now, in between jobs and looking for what's next. And I'm interested in sort of open learning communities, so, and open source.
Hi, I'm Katarina. I've sort of developed my own systems thinking approach to things, and now I'm trying to figure out what is right about it, what's not right about it, how to do it better.
I'm Andre, probably in Gilmore's 41. I'm coming from a lean TPS background, and I'm here because I had to come. We're actually talking about this at the other assistant thinking group in Toronto, and I got late at the end of the time here. It's not because I didn't want to, I didn't have the time to know.
My name's Hugo. I just finished up an industrial design degree at Vocad last spring. I just completed a hardware project at the Imagination Catalyst through OCAD, and I'm interested in systems thinking from the courses I took.
Cool. I'm Zach. I'm a communications strategist, and I'm also a current graduate in the SFI program. I'm interested in systems thinking to blend those two fields together, and interested to see where the systems changes projects goes. I have to use the changes, the plural part of it, as a system changes.
Yeah, it's hard to get used to that. Right. Yeah. Yeah. And Peter?
I'm Peter Jones. I know probably most of you, but I'm a professor of the Strategic Foresight Innovation Program here, as well as the Design for Health Program, both of which have systems courses, which we have evolved into the discipline of systemic design over the last decade of the SFI program. This has been the evolution of the relationship of systems thinking and systems theories into design practices. And so this is the approach we've been developing more and more and teach through the extension of visual formalism, some of which like you might see on, maybe not this whiteboard, but plenty in the other room, and in the Design for Health program, and we're teaching that right now as well. And one of the implementations of this is the relationship of systemic design and to systems as expressed in services and service design. And so primarily in healthcare, we're doing that. This is, I'm proud of this book, which is a result of, so it's Systemic Design, Theory, Methods, and Practice, a very expensive Springer book. But it has nice print quality, but it's a scholarly book of 10 chapters that I've edited over the last 2 years that were collected from the top authors from the RSD4 conference in Banff from 2015. And so that's how long it takes to get a book. A journal can be done in about a year. A book takes about 2 years, but you might know some of the people in the book. I can pass it around if you'd like to take a look to see what kinds of things are in it, if it doesn't distract too much. And I can't reveal the chapters yet, because it's just out, and Springer has to sell it. $180 a pop, they're going to sell it to libraries, but it's kind of an embargo. But I can make my chapters available to people later as they're reading them. I have two. Actually, one of them is already, it's just an introduction, but yeah, there's a big chapter in there.
Thanks. And so I'm David Ng, and the context that matters for this one is I've been active in the pattern language community since 2014 fairly intensively. So I've been at PLoP, the Pattern Languages of Programming Conference, which is a computer science people. I then went to PURPLSOC, which is the Pursuit of Pattern Language for Social Change, and those people tend to be out of Austria. And then I was at PURL, the Portland Urban Architecture Research Lab, which is architects. And so computer science, social change, and architecture. So what do all these things, all these people have in common? What are they trying to do?
Silly names.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure what it caused that. So since I'm one of the organizers of System Thinking Ontario, it's like, okay, I was trying to actually put together what should this session be about? Because there's been a lot of stuff that I've been doing over the past 5 years, and I'm trying to put it together. And a lot of it's already been around, but the best description of this really, learning from Christopher Alexander's legacy. And it's not just Christopher Alexander. The interesting approach that I have to learning a field is that I tend to not actually pay so much attention to the people who are the leading people in the field. I like to go to the grad students. The grad students in particular that I've been approaching, so I have a blog post called that has to do with Christopher Alexander, Horst Riddle, and Wes Churchman, who were all in Berkeley in the late 60s and early 70s together. And the joke was that, well, Alexander was in the architecture school at Berkeley at the same time that Horst Riddle, the person that invented the term wicked problems, came out. And so they were in the faculty together, and Wes Churchman is in the building next door in the business school. But Wes Churchman actually had Horst Riddle's article published in Management Science 4 years before Horst actually published it himself. So you have all these ties, and so what I've been doing is talking to all the grad students, because the grad students are the ones that actually took classes from all of them. As an example, Hayo Nice, who's now the head of the Portland Urban Architecture Research Lab, I talked to him about all of these people. Max Jacobson, who is one of the co-authors of the Pattern Language book, got to be really great friends with him and discuss a lot of stuff, and you'll see his photo later on. Most interesting one, Howard Davis, who is an architect and studied under Christopher Alexander, and I asked, did you take Horst Riddle's class? I said, okay, I went to the first lecture. Horst Riddle is this German guy, and he lectures with a cigar. And so I went to the first lecture, and with a cigar, I couldn't stay, so I never went back. So there's history of science for you. It has nothing to do with the content. It has everything to do with these human dynamics that go on. Okay? So the Christopher Alexander legacy is actually trying to understand what a lot of these people have been doing. And when we get down to the real fine points about why this is written and why that isn't written, it's very helpful to understand what it is. So the slide deck is available. It's on the coevolving.com website on the publications. It's also on the System Thinking Ontario site now if you want to follow along, as of like 3 hours ago. So there's actually 50 slides here. It's a little better than, let's see how far we get on these. I do have the intent to stop at 8:15, which is generally the rule I have, and then for those of you who want to join, we can have more discussion after over dinner at some place cheap down on Queen Street. So I on the agenda, I put on three things. Firstly, I was going to talk about the Aishin project in 1985, which is a Japanese high school. Then I was going to go back to 1968 and talk about Multi-Service Centers book, which is a rare book. I didn't even bring either of those books with me, anyway. I'll talk about that and the work I've had extending them, and then I was going to talk about what happens when we get outside of built environments and start looking at using pattern language in a different way and what that means. So as I was doing that, this other work came up, and I was reminded, this is a blog post, Systems Generating Systems. I actually blogged this in 2014, it's actually, this. I love this title, Loving and Hating Christopher Alexander. So Molly Wright Steenson, who in 2014 was doing her dissertation, actually wrote a lot about Christopher Alexander. You can read her dissertation and you get some of the fine points. And this is a really, really long blog post about trying to decipher a lot of what Christopher Alexander was trying to do. So you can follow up on that sometime when you're going somewhere. This is what the original article looks like. The original article, Systems Generating Systems, was done for Inland Steel Products. At the bottom of my blog, this is how the world works, is I got a response after I blogged in 2014, and the woman that responded said, I am the daughter of the person who funded this research. And this is for an art installation that was done for Inland Steel. It's part of this, and so... the writing is really interesting and direct, and so I'm going to spend probably the first quarter of the time going through the ideas here. But there were four ideas he had. So the first thing was, what's a system generated system mean? There are two ideas here in the system, the idea of a system as a whole and the idea of a generating system. Okay. Now, the system as a whole, when we talk about system thinking, is actually pretty common. We've heard that all before. The idea of a generative system is usually something that we usually don't discuss. And so if people were doing pattern language that would meet Christopher Alexander's standard, they would be doing generative pattern language. Now, there's a discussion in this that happens in computer science literature when it first came out. So Jim Kopelian, who is now the head of the Scrum Alliance, he's the chief methodologist, wrote this blog post on the original C2 wiki and made the distinction between a generative pattern language and what he called gamma patterns. Gamma is because there was a book called Design Patterns. It came out in computer science, which is elements of object-oriented software, and it was not generative. It was what he called a pattern catalog, not a pattern language. When I went to the PLoP conference in 2014, Ralph Johnson is one of the authors of that book. And so what he told me was that at that time, that this Hillside group that was forming, that actually is continued, this is the 25th annual meeting they just had, that they were starting up all this work. They were doing all this work in computer science, but it actually had nothing to do with the Design Patterns book. It just was coincidental at the same time. So people in computer science say, oh, I love the design pattern stuff, and it's kind of like, okay, well, let's see if you actually know that, you know, where it was supposed to go. So the second idea of the generating system is the part that's a little hard to get a hold of. Second point, the system as a whole is not an object, but a way of looking at an object. Okay, so we understand its perspective. It focuses on some holistic properties, which can only be understood as a product interaction among the parts. And so it talks about a candle and how the candle flame comes together. It talks about twisting threads together to make a system as a rope. That's not too revolutionary. Number three, a generating system is not a view of a single thing. It is a kit of parts with rules about the way these parts may be combined. Okay, the kit of parts idea is actually not so hard an idea, because in systems we talk about wholes, we talk about parts. The rules about the way these parts may be combined gets really, really complicated. The issue with these is, in effect, if you think about this and get down to systems, that one of the definitions I use is structure is an arrangement of parts in space. Process is an arrangement of parts in time. You can have all the parts and not put them together in the right order, and it won't work. So sequence becomes quite important. So the rules about the way these parts may be combined, when you start getting deeper into it, will be about how you put things together. And in Alexander's later writings, that gets to be a fundamental thing that people overlook.
Just a quick question in the middle of things.
Sure.
Is there an agent there that is doing the combination?
Good question, and a coming.
Thank
There'll be
you.
A coming. Okay. Almost every system as a whole is generated by a generating system. If we wish to make things which function as wholes, we shall have to invent generating systems to create them. Okay. So what does that mean? And there's actually some examples he puts after it that are helpful. So he talks about a hi-fi system, a stereo music system. So you have the parts, which is you have all the parts constructed, but then the generating system is a kit of parts and the rules governing the electricity between the parts. He talks about a railroad switchyard, where you have the trains, which is sequence of switches, lengths of tracks, and lengths of trains, but then the generative system is putting them all together. But for an animal, this is what he writes, which is not the best example. Talk about landing seagulls, a system, everything that seagulls do, and that the seagull is created by a genetic system. So we start getting this little issue about, well, what do you mean by generating system? Because you're not being very clear about it. Let's see what else says. Here you go. The generating system need not be conscious nor even explicit. Okay. Now we get a little confusion. Almost every system as a whole is generated by a generating system. To ensure the holistic properties of building and cities, he's an architect, we must first invent the generating systems whose part and rules will create the necessary holistic part properties of our own accord. Okay, now I'm really starting to get confused. To make objects with complex holistic properties, it's necessary to invent generating systems which will generate objects with the required holistic properties. Okay, this one is interesting. The designer becomes a designer of generating systems, each capable of generating many objects rather than a designer of individual objects. Okay, for those of you who are in the SFI program, there's your challenge if you can actually figure out what it means. But that's at the crux of the mystery around Alexander. So, you know, what does he mean by all that? Because he spent actually the next 50 years, this is a paper that's published in 1967, 68, and got republished. And then he actually spends the next 50 years trying to explain it to people who don't understand system thinking, and they're going, what the heck does all this mean? In a property function, the building and the people inside it form a whole, a social human whole. Okay, so he's an architect that recognizes people. The buildings which have been so far created do not, in this sense, generate wholes at all. So that's his position. He's saying architects don't understand human beings and people together, and how do you generate it? So this is kind of, I started taking this one apart because it's a really dense article. And if you actually start taking this and going now trying to apply it to the stuff that he wrote for the next 50 years, it's like, okay, I see a little bit here, I see a little bit there. Yes?
So the designer becomes a designer of generating systems is really like blowing my mind right now.
Yeah.
Only because I'm wondering about kind of the next level and always thinking about what's being infused into the system.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if that means that the designer as many objects as just their body of work,
So when you get down into systems theory, you would actually have to start thinking about systems that reproduce and systems that don't reproduce. So,
right.
Like, are you creating clones, or are you actually producing systems that can actually reproduce?
Right.
You know, so.
Would a simple-ish example of the generating system be a software program that, such as a word processor, Illustrator, PowerPoint, computer-aided software engineering, it's a set of little pieces and tools to create many different creations, each of which might be a system. So especially the computer software engineering.
No, because what I have to say is you'd actually need a creative person who could actually then put words together.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that there's the software plus the creative person, the designer of the novel or of the software or whatever.
Yeah.
But this all looks like a meta layer on top of systems.
Yeah, and so, yes, there is a meta layer, and actually as I was doing this presentation, I started seeing other places where it's kind of like, okay, he is talking meta.
There's a guy, Cesar Hidalgo, who works at MIT, who talks about knowledge and know-how being embedded, and that this is what that reminds me of, that the things are made from knowledge, but you have to have the know-how to be able to make that thing happen. And that's what I feel like we're talking about know-how.
Yeah, well, so there's a lot of people looking at Alexander, so I'll just leave this for now because it's a lot of interpretation. Peter?
I'd suggest that for SFI, a creative business strategy that can actually lead to business plans, to business models, to new outcomes, is a type of generative system that strategists can form if they go beyond just, you know, conventional strategy to a system of strategy with parts that yield the outcomes envisioned in that strategy. So for SFI, it's like a core deliverable, core product. And you see that as a process, not as a thing.
But you still have a strategist, so it's very similar to Illustrator, where you have design. So you still have that agent operating.
The strategist can leave, though, can leave behind that if they educate the organization. So the organization is doing strategizing, you could say. That
but
is
there's a life force.
There is, but the person can leave them. So the strategist, that is, we as advisors, can create that with an organization that leave, and it continues to generate because if it's been taken up by the organization. So it creates a social system that maintains it. I mean, the organization has skin in the game. They're the ones that are going to do the work, not the strategy advisor. So,
is that?
Yeah, just the way that I was interpreting it, a little along the lines of what Peter was saying, and maybe simplified down to actually the designer becoming one, or you design for the enabling relationships, human or not human, right? And so that's probably the mental space that you occupy, is that you're thinking about the design of potential relationships that can be formed.
But for instance, unintended consequences of creating systems or different things, those are speeding, not the right type of systems, but still
Well, that's an interesting point, is that generative doesn't necessarily mean positive, does
yeah.
it?
Yeah, I mean, if you think of Akoff and his example with the prohibition, okay, you try to tackle the alcoholism in the United States and then you get organized crime.
Yeah.
Right? So
yeah.
Those are big systems, one of them is spawning from this.
Yeah. Okay. So.
Sorry, can I ask one
yeah,
question?
Sure.
So would that mean that cancer would be a generative system?
Mm. Yes. Yeah. Could be.
Doesn't mean it has to be a desirable outcome.
Right.
Right.
But I'm just thinking about the like growth, the idea of generative growth, that it's just an ongoing.
Yeah.
And it multiplies itself.
It'd be more than
so. So if you, I mean, if you're having this idea of design, of it, the idea that if you do a word processing idea, you're creating a system, but it's just a tool. But if you're designing the components to make a system as opposed to making a system, that makes sense. You're deliberately making the components that you can use to plan and strategize another system.
But as opposed
to just creating the thing, which would be like document. The document
only
like
somebody's making templates or making software
yeah.
components.
Yeah.
That is a designer of a generating system.
Possibly.
Well, you need so it's more than the tools, though. You'd actually need to make sure you have the education or the training of the people that can actually then take it on, right?
Are we diverting you, David?
No, you're slowing things down a bit. So,
is anybody going to start talking about time series?
Later.
Thanks.
Later. Okay.
Story.
Okay. Okay. So, in 1967, Christopher Alexander founded the Center for Environmental Structure, which was a corporation done at Berkeley. And at that point, he actually said, so the question is going to be, well, what is a pattern? What is a pattern language? The format says that whenever a certain context exists, a certain problem will arise. Now, you're thinking buildings, and so you're thinking about, you know, how do I fit this arch into a room or something like that? The stated pattern will solve the problem and therefore should be provided in the context. Now, just this interesting thing was, just typing this, the solution is in the context. The solution is not in the, it's not in the problem. Last year when I was visiting in Shanghai, we had this, context is turning out to be a real problem as a word. My friend Susu had written a paper and had sent it in, and it came back with this review, and then we started discussing it. It turns out that the German interpretation of context doesn't mean what it means in English.
Graham Hurst, U of T, Artificial Intelligence Lab, he wrote a paper on context. But he was arguing that context is a meaningless word.
Okay. So
context.
So when we create pattern language, like this is pretty well this was in 1967, he's founding this research center, actually has this in the original document, right? So the people that tend to work on patterns tend to think about solution to a problem in context. That's what they say. And what I've seen with most people that work with pattern language is they do solution to a problem and they forget context. They try to think universal. So right from the beginning, there's people that are not looking at it the right way. By 1979, pattern has become context problem solution. So it says, the form of a rule which enables a relationship between a context, a system of forces which arises in that context, and a configuration which allows these forces to resolve themselves in that context. Is in this very form, context, system of forces, configuration. At this point, it's like, okay, I'm actually beginning to think that, and again, I'm just rereading it with the current research, I'm looking at things, I said, maybe we should call, now we have system here, a system of forces, maybe it's a subsystem. So there's these kind of, so people generally take the first definition and start using pattern language as a pattern catalog, and just say, you know, here I have a solution, problem, context, solution, problem, context, solution, problem, context. but they actually don't bundle them together to actually create something else. Now that would be the system of forces, because you can't do this because you're doing that. This doesn't fit here, or it doesn't in the wrong sequence. So there's a lot of confusion around that, which I eventually will get to and trying to straighten out. Okay, this is famous. It's a YouTube video. I blogged this one because it got written. This is the 1996 OOPSLA conference, Object-Oriented Programming I guess, languages or something. So languages and applications, I think. And so Alexander was invited in 1996, and you can go watch the video. The first 46 minutes he actually wrote up in an article that's published in IEEE, and then from there I actually went through and figured out what he said versus what he wrote, because there's a big divergence of that after the first 43 minutes. But the net is, for the people that were actually there, which some of my colleagues were, in effect he said, "I'm a building architect. Nice you guys using pattern language. I don't know what you're doing, but you guys are missing the point." The point in the pattern language that he was looking for was some sort of, well, take the simplest one, he's looking for beauty. It's not about how you put these things together. So if we're looking at software, you should not be using pattern language in order to describe how you plug code together. The question is whether your software is actually helping the world. And so that's been taken as one of the things, as one of the landmarks where people go when they go, oh, you know, we use pattern language in software development. They say, well, are you fulfilling what Christopher Alexander actually wanted? Does your software actually help? Are you using pattern language in that way, or is it just to fix something that's broken down in the code? Alana?
Yes, so are we doing something to make the world better? Is it beautiful? That sounds to me like a mission statement or it's axiomatic. And when I looked at Alexander's pattern language, because I borrowed from the library a couple days ago, what I saw was that there were certain trends of architectural wishes running through the pattern language. Trends like human comfort or social community and architecture that enables social community. But the book would be a lot shorter if it said, make the building so that there is good social community around it. And that doesn't sound to me like the language. That sounds to me like the objectives or goals of the language, which aren't really explicit on page one.
Right.
So I think that's the issue I'm having. That I'm seeing a pattern and a language of patterns, but not a set of explicit goals like beauty or community connection.
So
you know how you said context is about fitting an arch into a room? That's not what context means in architecture. What Christopher Alexander was talking about actually dates back to hundreds of years, and it's pretty mainstream in architecture, and we have theories expressed in critical regionalism. Architects have always been worried about not intervening, putting something foreign into some community that they have no knowledge of. Mm-hmm. That creates discomfort. Mm-hmm. So the impulse for architects has always been to get from the context what it needs, or make the site the best of what it can be. This is pretty standard in architecture. And why that book is thick is because city building involves a lot of mechanics, because human life, as different as they are from region to region, they share a particular mechanic, and to have a community to enable life, you need to know certain things, like how to make a street, how to partition, so on and so forth. That's why.
Oh, yeah, for an architect, you need to be this thing.
And at the last meeting in October, Hayo Nice, who's one of the authors of these works, asked me, well, what are you saying about built environments? And I said, Christopher, I'd have nothing to say about built environments, because I don't work in built environments. Christopher Alexander has done this work. It's entirely appropriate for the stuff you're doing. The problem is that people are taking it to places like computer science and then understanding what the whole idea was. And so they're doing all the mechanical stuff. They're not trying to look for wholeness, they're not trying to look for life, they're not doing any sorts of things. And so you can look for, you know, a pattern language of user interface pattern language. So, you know, user interface pattern language you think might have users in it, but it really doesn't. It has like buttons and, you know, these sort of conventions in it. So, yes?
There's actually a new book by Jorge Arango that is called Living in Information. Then he came from architecture to now more information and computer systems. He comes from a very UX kind of background and is now looking at, I don't even know that there's crossover in kind of the information systems here, but it's interesting to me to see people coming back and saying like, oh wait, this is the thing that now UX designers are using that book as their kind of guide for shaping experience.
Okay, so this is Max Jacobson, one of the co-authors of that book, now retired. He was a grad student of Christopher Alexander, so it was great to talk to him. And the way they wrote that book was, it took them 10 years, and they had like 6-8 people in a room, and they would talk about the pattern language, and they would say, the interesting part of them is they have, every pattern has 1-star, 2-star, 3-star, 4-star, whatever. And how confident they are that it should or should not go into the book. And so he said, they used to sit around, they'd be in a funk because someone said, this pattern's not good enough to go in the book. And they go, yes it is, no it isn't. And so I'm going to go arguing back and forth, and they had a lot of that going on. So the interesting part to me was he actually said, pattern languages are not for wicked problems. And so this is crossing over Christopher Alexander to Horst Riddle, and he was in both classes, and so he knows. And so he told me that specifically use pattern language when you don't have a wicked problem. It's like, wait a minute. So now we have a conference called Pursuit of Pattern Languages for Social Change. So what's the premise behind the whole conference? That you could use a pattern language for social change. Okay, if you're going to do that, then you can't blame Christopher Alexander for stuff you're doing because that's not what he was doing. He was building built environments, right? So that means that people should be looking at trying to fix some of those things, and that's what I've been working on for a while. Okay, so a lot of people start off and start reading a pattern language, and actually this pattern language is not the first book of the series. It's actually The Timeless Way of Building is actually the earlier volume, but it got published in order because it's 1979 and this is 1977. And people focus on this, but the timeless way of building is the fundamental of agile software development. And so people focus on this, focus on the wrong one. The Oregon experiment was the way in which the University of Oregon campus plan was created. And so it was a combination of these two put into practice back, I think it's 1980 it got published. And in October, we actually had the chief architect, the retired chief architect from the University of Oregon, who said that, in effect, they used that in the planning of the University of Oregon for 30 years, 40 years, but now they've, in effect, been thrown out. So they're no longer using that. He was complaining about some of the way that buildings are designed, the campus plan, and how things don't fit on the campus plan anymore. My recommendation to anyone that is interested in pattern language is do not start at the earliest, you start at the end. You start with the last book that Alexander wrote, the 2012 book, because there's a difference between talking about what you're going to do and actually doing it. In 1985, he's actually doing it. And so you can infer your own methods, and that's what I'm going to do here. So I'm going to talk about the Eichen School, 1985. This is the Eichen School at Eichen.ac. The project was for Christopher Alexander to create a combination university, college, and high school on a greenfield land. And in 1985, it finished. I got to visit this. Here's Tokyo. Took the train out and came out to visit the high school. It was funny that I was actually the way I was doing is I was looking at the book online. I ordered the book on Friday morning, and it turns out you can actually have the book delivered to you on Friday afternoon, and so I had that. And then Friday night I sent an email to Tokyo which said, I am in Tokyo on Monday, can I come visit your high school? Because I was literally going there for the Tokyo Institute of Technology meetings we normally have. And so I had two sons with me, and I had photographs of all that. But When I arrived there, actually I arrived on Monday, and then Tuesday I actually went to the high school. And it turns out I was there before the Japanese architects were. This is what the site looks like. There's a pond, if you look at it, Google Maps, this is actually man-made. But this was all tea fields originally. And so here's where I think it's valuable to look at this. Now, this is a summary of the book. How is it you actually use pattern language? This is what it's supposed to do. Firstly, you're not supposed to take that book and use that book. What you're supposed to do is you're supposed to go to the clients and create a pattern language with your clients. And so in this case, this was a high school. He went and interviewed on the hopes and dreams, and you end up with these sorts of patterns, these interesting patterns. One I like best is that teachers want to be able to see the eyes of their students. That was one of the things that they said. We want to be able to do that. Tune, make a poetic vision of the first sketch of a pattern language. This is just trying to get feedback and work on do you understand what's about. Make the rudimentary pattern language physically coherent. You're actually trying to now put things together because you got all these, you could call them requirements, you call them hopes and dreams, desires. You're trying to put all these together, but can you actually put them together? Refine the language through discussion. Obtain approval of the pattern language. They're actually going to build a real building. This is, you know, pretty serious. Renegotiate the pattern language with space and money within the budget. Find the systems of centers in the pattern language and in the land. I'll describe these in more detail. And then adjust the site plan on the site itself, not on models. So interviewing on hopes and dreams, pretty standard. Interviewing and going in, so we're not going to cover that. Making the poetic vision, I'm not going to go over that. I'm going to jump down. I actually have these all done in the 2016 paper, I think, or 2015 paper. But I'm going to jump down and go to number three. Make the rudimentary pattern language physically coherent. So this is what they tried to do. So there's a main gate, there's an entrance street, public yard, great hall, home base street. The high school is over here. The idea was a college would be towards the back of the campus. You've got some trees over here, you've got a gymnasium, you've got a lawn. So he's actually trying to really form this all out. And so how does he know when he's done? So there are seven principles, he said. There are relationships, spatial, reliability, consistency, inconsistency, completeness, and coherence. And so what he's trying to do is translate those ideas where we have a library, we have a gym, you know, we have these students that want to come in, all these sorts of things, and make it something. And so we start off with rough drawings. Number five, obtain approval of the pattern language. So this goes down to these centers, and he's got eight centers. And out of this, I'm going to 1.1 here. So here's a pattern. An outer boundary supports the campus. Number two, contained by the outer campus is this outer precinct. There's an inner precinct as a whole. So he's actually trying to now describe what he was doing in that drawing before in more text. Okay, so this is the front gate when you come up to the school. This is actually the worst snowfall they've had in a really long time in Japan. They're shoveling it. It's interesting being in Japan because on this visit, we went down to the southern coast of Japan, and it was covered. We started the day, it was covered, all the pavement was covered with snow. What the Japanese people do is that they shovel the snow and they put it down the drain. Like, you don't have to do that here in Toronto, shoveling snow and putting it down the drain, because by the afternoon we got there, there was no snow left on the walk. It's incredible. Anyway, so this sort of thing where he'd like this idea that when you came in to the front gate that there would be this arc coming around. And so this is what it really looks like now. Renegotiate the pattern language within the space and with money and budget. So after he figured out public yard and all these sort of buildings, how much space to actually take, okay, it's 17,990 square meters. Now, they can't afford that. They can afford to build 13,000 square meters. And so what he did was he said, okay, we're going to take this and we're going to shrink everything down 73%. So if you guys want to build this, we have a budget to build this amount. And the only thing you can do now is to increase, if you want to increase the home-based street buildings, you have to reduce it somewhere else. Okay. Now, in the pattern language stuff that people talk about, even in software development, you never see them following all the way through. They kind of describe stuff, but they don't get down to discussing the constraints. And so as you were saying, there's a lot of geometry, and what I like in the original Chris Rowley Vander work, the original charter, it actually has a really nice pattern about street signs when you're driving on the street. If it's a busy street, you need bigger street signs because people driving by can't read the signs. If it's a quiet street, you can get away with a smaller street sign. Okay, how big is big? And they actually were specified. And so that's the sort of thing that we see in the detail here. But the idea that the pattern language is there and helping you trying to work through this, trying to get down to the end where it's like, okay, here we renegotiated it and had these meetings that people said we can reallocate spaces is quite interesting.
David, I'm a little confused. So I thought a pattern language was a set of like templates, principles for many different buildings. And now we're talking about one complex of buildings, like one school location.
Yes.
Why would we call that one building complex a pattern or a pattern language rather than an implementation thereof? It's like an instance.
So this is Christopher Alexander at work. So firstly, the pattern language is specific for that community. So it uses a language not from the book. It uses a language they understand. So, you know, there's nothing about students in that book. There's nothing about a college. Like, that's, you know, that's a very general sort of thing. And so this is one of the big mistakes is people look at that book and they go, oh, I should use this. And then they pick it up and look at, oh, yeah, I recognize this. But then that's because you're placing yourself into the book. If you had to actually create plans and have an architect come in and work with you, it'd be much more of a conversation. They wouldn't say, you know, here's a book.
Okay, so this is more like they interviewed the people, the stakeholders, the people concerned to find out what are the general aims and principles that you need in your kind of building complex.
Yeah, yeah.
In your school.
Yeah. Peter?
I'd say that's consistent with what's called a design language, too. So John Weinfreund, who did a lot of work around this when he was around, he was at Carnegie Mellon, and in the 90s, work he did on this that was revealed on design languages that he had done and followed some of these principles is based on the construction of patterns for particular projects where, you know, a language of design objects. So you could think of a whole business system with, you know, word marks, typography, brand guidelines, and the specifications used for the representation of the company, values of the company, just the identity. All of those, we can think of them as components of a business system, but in, you know, considering them in a pattern language approach, it's called a design language when it's like a system of parts that generates the expression of that of the identity of that product or that service or system. So Reinfrank and Evenson have done a lot of work with Hugh Deverly as well, so some of their work with them on Hugh Deverly's website, but I think the design language, which he wrote up just, I think, once in Terry Wittegrat's collection, Bringing Design to Software, and it's a really powerful short piece. It's kind of a secret of his that he had derived, you know, a practice of design language that he had used as kind of a secret weapon for a long time.
I think now they call that design ops at startups.
Well, that's different. Yeah, I mean, that's actually the functional implementation of design within the process. But the creation of how the product is generated and how it's expressed, that comes well before that. It's like a style, like a very advanced style guide. Yeah, think of it.
Yeah.
I was wondering, because you've got this idea of languages that define things and name things, like a taxonomy or whatever, but if you have a dimension that can be varied, how does that relate? Like, for instance, it looks like you've got a dimension of space or size, and that can vary on a continuum as opposed to being present or not present.
Yeah, this is where, we'll get to the other book, the 1968 book on multi-service centers was helpful, because that was a book that had, so a multi-service center was a government building where you could actually get medical support, mental health, housing, all that stuff in one building. But when you actually read the book, it's like, well, this one is done at in a suburban location, this one's done in an urban location. So you have to scale things down, and you know, it doesn't have a parking lot, doesn't have a parking lot, does it have to be near public transportation, all these things get into consideration. And so there were multiple pattern languages for each of them. Now, part of this is cleaning up the language, like what is a pattern, what is a pattern language? The pattern language is all the patterns in a language. Some of the people, actually coming out of Japan, one of the people that actually worked on this project, they've been using the term project language, because when you come down to actually doing the whole thing, there could be sub-projects underneath it, in which case you need a language to describe what it is you're working just in the project, not the whole site.
Yeah. Sorry, that was project language?
Project language, yes.
The way I understand it, and this looks like part of the contract documents, that so architects don't build buildings, they manage the construction of buildings, and buildings are a million decisions that architects make on behalf of the client. And the way they get the client to agree is that through a basis of agreement, and that basis of agreement is the pattern. It's like, I'm going to make a million decisions on your behalf because this fits the pattern that we agreed on. So the pattern might be, you know, whenever there's a corner, we do a little thing, you know, all that. That is the agreement, and then there are a million instances that are automatically, which makes that decision. Yeah.
Right.
I find it curious, though, that they are in relation to each other. Like that he can just go, okay, well, let's just shrink those by 73%, and then we're good, because that doesn't feel...
No, that wasn't good. The whole purpose is... No, that was arbitrary to force them to make harder decisions.
Okay.
That was the initial position, is we'll shrink everything 73% because that's what your budget will allow. But obviously, that's not the ideal, because you're going to say, oh, well, that wasn't important, and we need to shrink this and increase
right,
that more.
That felt very
Yeah. You can only add if you subtract somewhere else. Okay, the next three are interesting. Find the systems of centers in the pattern language and place in the land and combine them. Now, this is the interesting part that people would never think about in pattern languages, which there's a pattern language in the buildings, and there's a pattern language in the land. And what you're trying to do is locate them on top of each other. So originally, this was the seven most important centers. You started off with the buildings and in this layout. But then on top of that, it's got a swamp down here, natural entrance, a ridge, and these things around. So you've got buildings and land, you're trying to put them together, which are in effect two systems. You got a system on land, and you got a system, and how do you match those systems together? And so they were having a lot of problems with it, and what they eventually figured out was originally the entrance for the campus, I believe, was to the south, and they moved it to the east. So they took the buildings and they turned them 90 degrees, and that worked. But they only got that after they started doing the balsa wood models. So instead of entrance street main square, so the first two were the right thing, they had to rearrange the order of the other two things that would fit in.
David, where's the swamp in that model, do you know? I mean, that had to be the biggest constraint because that's the water runoff.
Yeah, it must be this right here. That was the lowest point, and so fitting stuff around that was definitely a challenge. And then finally, adjust the site plan on the site itself, not on models. And this is where, in agile software development, you're not supposed to build, you're not supposed to write documentation. You're supposed to be working on the code itself. In this case, what happened was that there were T fields, and so he had this battle about the flags. He needed markers in the ground, and he wanted to do it, and so he put flags in, but then there was all this issue about I think they've not yet settled on the price of the land, and take them out, put them back in, take them out, put it back in. But the idea is that describing something and having it in real life are not the same thing. And so before, when I showed you the arc coming up to the front building, that was one of the things. It's like, well, how can we see that arc? And he would do that by putting these posts up and then putting flags on the land. Okay, so I'm going to skip ahead on this, but there's an idea that in the generativity, there's stuff that's written a little bit later. Christopher Alexander had written about this, about the structures of patterns, not solutions, they generate solutions. And this is really confusing to most people. Most people won't get to this level when they're doing the pattern language work. And this one's actually written by Jim Copeland, and he is the, as I said, the chief scrum methodologist. So when we see the Scrum PLoP book coming out, it's like, oh, okay, there's something going on here. Also end up with unfolding, which is a process that changes over time. So it's not just the building a static point. The idea would that be that the building should get better as you go along if more people live in it. Okay, so I'm going to go back quite a few years to 1968 to the Multi-Service Centers book. And this is the original idea behind pattern language. Why do you want to do one? So this is on the cover of the book. And these are all the individual patterns. And this is the only place I've actually seen it. But in this book, he doesn't have this drawing. But in 1968, here's essentially the idea. You have these patterns, and they connect to each other. For a systems person, the large-scale stuff is at the top. The small-scale stuff is at the bottom. So it means you have to do stuff up top before you do it at the bottom. So why do you do it? You want to pay respect to unique features. Which patterns to do first? Which one to do later? So large scale, the biggest ones and the details. And which patterns go together? So you put them together. I'm going to pick on some excerpts. These are three patterns that went together, 21, 28, and 23. But in order to focus you down so you can see what's happening, I'm going to put it in this format. This is pattern 32. So I told you before that the idea behind the multi-service center was that someone coming in, could be mental health issues, could be drug issues, whatever it is, they're coming to this place. And one of the issues is, what do you do with the kids? And so he had this one place called child care position. The child care position is visible along the path from the entrance to the services. So you come into the building, and it's like, oh, I put my kids here while I go kind of register over there or deal with whatever I have to do. Completion of larger patterns. Well, firstly, you have to have the entrance location done before you can talk about the child care position. And you need it open to the street. So you have to be able to see, get into the building. The range of context, this is a physical feature set of conditions. A child care station, any building where mothers have prolonged business, multi-service center, supermarket. So he's trying to generalize this context, as he says it. The problem to be solved, which is a system of forces arises. When small children are left off in child care centers, they're often extremely anxious and feel deserted, create circumstances under which the child decides of its own accord they want to play in the center. So kids, you want kids to play with other kids, you don't want them, you know, while their mother's trying to get housing or get food stamps or whatever, like, want the kids off by themselves. The solution, the child care station to be on the path from the building entrance to the place of business, visible from this path, looks into the child care station roughly 20 feet along its length. And so now you can see it's starting to get into some of the metrics associated with it.
IKEA.
Yeah. Except that IKEA, is the ballroom by the entrance, or do you have to go to the...
Right in the entrance.
Yeah, right in the entrance, right? So the kids go there. Right. Completion of smaller patterns. So after you've done that position, then you can do the contents later. You don't have to do that right away. Now, the proposal I have is to change the way that the format of the patterns. And I do this as who plus what, how plus why, where plus when, and the containing and the contained. So in this case, what Christopher Alexander said in this 1968 book, he said, I'm an architect, I don't do organization work. So I'm just designing the physical space, you have to talk to someone else about designing the organization. But I work in service systems, I'm interested in organizing the system, the social systems. And so when I suggest a pattern label, minding children, have the voices on the issues, the who and the what, and I like posing these as questions. For a client, what services are available to me now and on the appointment? For a parent, what can I do with my kids while I'm busy? For a child, what can I do while my parents are at the multi-service center? So as opposed to saying solution, problem, context, we start off with the voices on issues. The first issue with doing this is Christopher Alexander, in his work, he has a lot of work on Turkish carpets. And the idea he would do is, here are two carpets. There's one on the left and one on the right. Which one speaks more to you? Which one do you find more beautiful? And I think that most people pick the one on the left. Almost everyone picks the one on the left. And Richard Gabriel, who was the person that brought this in computer science, said that everyone likes the one on the left except the computer science people who like the one on the right. And so forth. They're wrong. And I'm going, oh, I don't necessarily believe that. When you do service systems, you can't treat everyone the same. Christopher Alexander stuff is trying to get to the average typical person as opposed to tailoring to a specific community, but services are different. So I'm looking at that. There is no who in the Christopher Alexander patterns. Fine, you know, so that's the way it is. But you can tell, now I've now explained to you from the 1985 work, it's not that he ignores the people, because he interviewed the people, but doesn't show up in the patterns because it's already there, because that's where he got all the patterns from in the first place. He didn't take the book and say, this is the pattern I'm throwing at you, right? But if you're designing a service system, then you've got different constituent stakeholders and you should look at them in different ways. The affording values, how and why do you do this? So leaving a child at a supervised play area so their whereabouts are known, availing distractions to toddlers through teens, becoming the parents of less mature, spatiotemporal frames, when and where. The facilities and programs are known to children and parents in advance of appointments. And so it's not enough actually to put child minding in the place. The parents have to know when they come there they can bring their kids, because otherwise, people miss appointments. You know, I couldn't make that appointment because I couldn't find a babysitter. It's like, well, you know, we actually have babysitting there. Oh, I didn't know that. Well, then that has to be part of the pattern. Containing systems, what's slower or larger? For an extended family, schools, community workers, what are the personal responsibilities that inhibit service engagement? So when we talk about babysitting, you know, you could get someone else to do the babysitting, but are they taking responsibility? Are they not taking responsibility? You know, is this now a licensed daycare sort of situation? You're going to need those sorts of people. Containing systems, which are faster and smaller. For other parents at the multi-service center at the same time, would you look after my kids while I look after yours? That's something that could happen there. But that's not part of the original design, something to worry about afterwards. So my proposal for this, and this is the formality, this is the 2016 proposal, the pattern label, which is interaction phrase of the present participle, and this is actually in my book, in Open Innovation Learning, the way I describe the stuff that I did is actually pattern language, and that's how I worked on this at the same time. And so when people go, I've written pattern language, we never talk about pattern language in my book because most people don't even know what that is. So it's very confusing, but that's one of the contributions I have from doing dissertation work. So this is the proposal, which is a different view from solution to a problem in context. It has the who and what, the how and why, and the when and where. Okay, beyond built environments. So this is the paper that I had written for the meeting, and you can download this. This was in 2016, I had written this paper. And I go through all of these. This is a proposal I'd like to bring to the system changes program, because I'd like to do pattern language, but I'd like to do it for service systems, not for buildings. You can download that. Okay, so the first thing, and this was actually something I just discovered this October, was a pattern manual. It says, the pattern language will contain hundreds of subsystems and tens of thousands of individual patterns. And so this was really helpful to me because, firstly, this means that a subsystem is larger than a pattern. So what I hope to do in the March 7th and 8th classes will be discussing what's the difference between a pattern, and what's a system. What's the difference between the two? And we start getting this generating a physical structure, growing continuous improvement, this sort of thing. But the idea that goes back to 1967, 1968, with Christopher Alexander, was working in systems. I wish he had spent more time over talking to Wes Churchman when he was at Berkeley.
Those guys didn't all get along according to Harold Nelson.
Yes, that's the problem. Yeah.
He was there at the same time, too. Yeah.
Yeah. So we have the idea of systems, subsystem, and patterns. We have scales where they're somehow connected together. We did work on some of this about this is contained in that, and how these things relate to each other. We'll have to put them into sequences. Where you get a change, where this is a regime shift at a system level, adaptive shift at a subsystem level, pattern sequences. And going in between patterns.
Can I just ask you, what's a regime shift
involved? Regime shift, the reason I've been using that term actually comes out of resilience literature. And so a regime shift is a change. So fundamentally, the basis of the resilience literature is there are multiple stable states that are possible. And so we talk about a lake. We have one lake that is flourishing. We have one that's dead. There's going to be a tipping point at which you get chemicals flowing into a lake, and all of a sudden it flips and dies. That would be called a regime shift. And so it has nothing to do with the political. It actually comes out of ecology. Yeah. Okay, so what do I like, Mr. Alexander's work? And how do I take the service system thinking? So I like shared meaning on the situated, which means that when we talk about pattern language, it's not supposed to be about the book. It is actually supposed to be in discussion with the people who are being changed by the system. There's this idea of system thinking complexity, where we had system generating systems. And I like that he wrote method content and the development process, because the timeless way of building and a pattern language are actually both there. Now, one of the things that I was around and fortunate to know is that when all this stuff was coming into computer science at IBM, the IBM Global Services method was constructed as pattern language. And IBM actually eventually donated that to the Eclipse Foundation. Some other time I can show you on the slide deck where they have a separation of the method content from the development process. But that's the sort of stuff that happens. So that, I like this in the Alexander language. Re-philosophizations. Okay, so what do we need to change? We need to change from structuralism to alternative stable states. What Alexander gets right is the criticism of teleology. Teleology is the study of ends or means or goals. A lot of what happens in business is oriented towards goals. But biology doesn't have a goal in that sense. It doesn't. It evolves along a path. That doesn't mean that it doesn't make decisions or changes. But we'll have a nice discussion about anticipatory systems sometime, because changes are not about the future, they're about the present, and actually acting on past history. The idea of moving from dwelling to journeying, this is actually somewhat a misreading of Heidegger. And when people talk about being and time, when you actually think about being, when you actually read the text closely, you start to realize being is not necessarily a point in time. It can be over a period of time. But when most people think about being, they tend to think about a point in time. And for semi-lattice to a meshwork, what happens is there was a book called The City Is Not a Tree, where in effect he says you can't break the tree, you can't describe a city as a pure hierarchy. You have these joints down at the bottom. And what happens is that when I've been working with stuff in social systems, you end up with actually in a full mesh diagram. It's a network. Hierarchy means it has to start at the top and work at the bottom, and you saw the drawing where it was the hierarchy, but it had joins at the bottom, but I tend to think of things in full networks, so I'd like to see that change. Reinterpretations of what we've been doing. From problem solving to issue seeking. So those who have been around the wicked problems literature, the first problem is if anyone ever writes a book and says, you know, that we have wicked solutions to wicked problems, then the first thing I say is, have you read the original 10 points of Horace Riddle's first book? Because he says that number one, you can't solve a wicked problem. You can only change. You can change the system, but you can't make it better or worse. You make it better for some people, but it works for someone else. There's no solution. And that's when we got into issues. There's an idea from quality wholeness to interactive value. And Christopher Alexander struggled with this throughout the 50 years he was writing. But you get down to appreciating a carpet as opposed to engaging someone interactively. And so when on the first slide we're talking about loving and hating Christopher Alexander, it's interesting that the people who are interaction design seem to like Christopher Alexander, but that's not what he was writing about, because he wasn't writing about the interaction in that way. And then from anti-patterns to wayfaring, there's a question as where anti-patterns came out. So anti-patterns came out of the computer science literature and saying that in effect patterns are desirable and anti-patterns are doing things the wrong way and you shouldn't do things that way. But then in effect what they're doing is they're missing the context, because it could be that that pattern's appropriate, you just can't use it in that context, in which case anti-patterns can make sense. Wayfaring is from Tim Ingold's work. And it's much more about understanding the situation you're in and understanding and appreciating where you are at that moment. And so it puts context in the more forward. Okay, part of the understanding that is going to require, and I'll be lecturing a lot about this, is a distinction between a behavioral approach to systems and an ecological approach to systems. And this came from J.J. Gibson. The best description of this, if you think about the period that behavioral psychology came out, behavioral psychology, you have Pavlov's dog, they ring the bell, the dog salivates. And so what they're trying to do is to get inside the dog's head. J.J. Gibson was actually focused on a different issue. He was focused on trying on the question of how does a pilot land, a Navy pilot, land a plane on a aircraft carrier? Because you're on, it's on the ocean, and that's moving, and you've got the plane coming down and moving together. And so he created what's called the ecological approach to perception, which is that it's not about what's inside the pilot's head. You have to actually be able to make the adjustments in ecology together. So ecology is not what you think it is. When people use the word ecology, behavior is what's inside your head, but ecology is not what's inside your head, but what your head is inside. So when we think about systems, a lot of the stuff we tend to think about inside the system, and what we should be doing is thinking outside the system.
Wow. Wow. That's an absolutely brilliant way of putting it.
That's why it's in the last section of the last chapter of my book. Someone just asked me about that, and it's like, okay, it's written up, and they looked at it, and they go, oh, I don't see that.
I actually own Gibson books. I don't think I've ever seen that book.
Yeah, this is actually, so I got this through Tim Ingold, who extended the work of Bateson. I never understood the Bateson stuff, and this is where Bateson was at. Bateson, in effect, created, it was named after he died, ecological epistemology. So this is a different approach, but when we think about systems, the question is, are you inside the head, or are you trying to think about the head's inside? I was having this discussion with one of my friends, and I actually take ecological. So I met a woman at another meetup who is having a few psychological difficulties. I can't get inside her head. I said, come to System Thinking Ontario. I said, come here once. You'll like it, and you'll like the people, and you'll come back, or you'll hate them, and you'll never come back. And I don't really care either way. I can't get inside your head. I can change your environment. I can change your environment for you, and you can decide whether you like it or not. And so I don't try to figure people out. For the people who signed up that didn't come, something must have happened. I don't blame them for not coming. They had something else happen, maybe something more important. I don't know. Not my judgment. I can offer this. Come, don't come. So affordances are relational in an ecological perspective, and this is actually now a review of Gibson's. But an affordance refers to whatever about the environment that contributes to the kind of interaction that occurs. And so one way of describing an affordance, a doorknob affords you the ability to pull on a door. Right? That's a usual example they talk about. If you do not recognize the doorknob as a doorknob, it is not an affordance. And this is when you start getting into the discussions with Don Norman, who talked about the design of the trash can on the Macintosh. And he called that an affordance and then had to retract and call it, well, there's a real affordance, a perceived affordance. Which is, no. You got it wrong, Don. If you came to the Mac for the first time and you didn't know how to delete a file, the trash can was not an affordance because you didn't know what it was. That's Gibson's definition.
Yeah, he retracted and developed it as a sign, a semiotic affordance. But he did go in the right direction with signs.
Semiotics. And so I like Tim Ingold's description of this. And so he talks about co-responding. And this is where I'm interested in looking at systems in a different way. And so he talks about habit. So when people walk, is it you walking? Like, do you actually move your feet, or is it the ground with you? Agencing, are you actually participating with the people who are around you? It's all ecological, right? And then attentionality. I love this picture of people jumping, because it hardly matters where they hit the water. They just don't want to hit each other when they come on top of the water, when they'll come down, right? So you want to actually have attentionality rather than intentionality. So the ecological perspective is a really interesting change. Some of that is in Alexander's intent and part of the confusion he's having, because he's an architect trying to build things that are around, that are systems that are not inside the system, but systems are working with each other. And so working through this, I kind of gotten a better understanding for how all that kind of goes together. So that's the end of Christopher Alexander. You can see that I'm kind of weaving stuff in and around that. The System Changes Project, I'm still looking for people. I especially love grad students because I'm trying to look at using patterns in that context and actually get the issue I have with the pattern language as it is, and now you can kind of understand, it's not about the patterns per se. It's the patterns that you assemble into a subsystem. And can you actually make the subsystems, and then will the subsystems actually fit together into a system? Meanwhile, everything is changing over time. And we're at 7:55. We have 20 minutes for discussion, and we'll adjourn. So, yes.
So, because I have not been to the PLoP conferences and stuff, I'm wondering what sort of topics have people created pattern languages about?
There are security patterns. There are like when they all do stuff. The PLoP conferences specifically are around building software. Now, what happens is it gets crashed by people like me because they have all of the right heritage, but the people in computer science are not using it to make the world better.
Or maybe in other fields beyond computer science.
So the PURL conference has been interesting. There's been a there's a tsunami avoidance pattern language. That's one that they worked a lot on. That's quite interesting when you get down to looking at that, because if the water is going to flood to 10 meters, then you want to go this direction. But if you take the forecast by 20 meters, that one's going to be underwater. So now you have to go the longer distance to the other place that could be safer. And they're doing this actually for the Oregon coast. So so tsunami, there's actually two of them doing that. There's all sorts of other patterns. So the person doing the most amount of work in this is actually Takashi Iba from Keio University. Now, I would say that he's not necessarily writing generative patterns, but he has, you go to Amazon, you can see his books. He's got like beauty patterns, like actually cosmetic beauty type of patterns. Because he's contracted, I think, to do that by a cosmetics company. He does presentation patterns.
So looking in particular for facilitation, what are the patterns and languages?
Tom Atley has actually been developing an extensive and collaborative.
Atley?
Atley. He was kind of the visionary behind the GroupWorks deck, even though the GroupWorks deck, GroupWorks deck.org. Behind that, so if you go beyond the GroupWorks deck, you'll see Tom's work on, now he's got working on a pattern language for democratic deliberation, so going beyond facilitation to the purposes of facilitation and democratic engagement to try to solve the problems of people not wanting to deliberate across political boundaries. So he's been working on this for probably a good 10 years or so.
So there's three major pattern work. So the GroupWorks is the one that's the most known, which is facilitation. The Wise Democracy one, Tom Atley has been working on. They're available. He doesn't have them as a card deck. You can download them and print them yourself. And then the third one, the Liberating Structures one, came out of the Public Sphere project. And that's Doug Schuler, and he's in Seattle. So
that's all online too. Like the Liberating Structure website is incredible.
Yeah,
I think it'd be Liberating Voices.
Liberating
Structures is the collection of other facilitation methods, most of which are not unique. They're just gathered.
They're together.
They're like TRIZ and all these kind of granular methods you can combine in facilitation. And there's a good community that some of you may have been to with Liz Riker that practices those. But the Liberating Voices was the public. And there's a good book with that encapsulates those methods. He's been developing those. Permaculture, I would say the permaculture community is probably one of the better known, dedicated communities that's been using Timeless Way of Building and the pattern language in a dedicated way in their permaculture training and in helping people create permaculture communities and to apply that in everything from backyard gardens to small farms to community development. So they incorporate that directly in their training and try to live, you know, I mean, they are trying to create beauty with the kind of parts of land and parcels that, as they were dealt, you know, very much trying to work with the land as it's given to them and make the best out of it.
One of the funny things about the Liberating Voices one, because I met Doug Schuler last year, actually. He was in Shanghai the same time I was. I met him in Shanghai in April, and then I saw him in October. And when he wrote the Liberating Voices book, it was published by MIT Press, and he wanted to take the format that is in the Alexander book, which is drawings and photographs and text. And MIT Press said no. And so I had to print it without it. And then what happens is that people started complaining, and so he actually reduced everything down into cards. And so now you can actually get the Liberating Voices card deck, and I actually have a copy of the card deck. But that's also been shaping one of the other things that came out from the that's part of the history, is that when the pattern languages reached the computer science community, Ward Cunningham was part of that, and he invented the wiki technology to support pattern language. Not Wikipedia, he invented the wiki technology. And so now he's worked on the second generation. Robert's been has his federated wiki as well and been working on that. And part of what I spent most of December writing one page, but my contribution would be, you gotta stop calling it a wiki page, you have to start calling it a card. Because people can actually understand you have cards. Now, the issue is now I've described as a card with these pattern languages, you have one card each pattern. The question is, how do you combine cards? Because it's supposed to be generative, right? It's not supposed to be about the cards, it's supposed to be how you generate them. So that's one that Ward has not yet tackled, that I would like to see.
Recreating paper cards.
It's a hand.
We're back there, that's exactly what we're doing.
This sounds a lot like Zuckerman's primitives and composites, for those who know the Zuckerman framework for enterprise architecture, which, you know, he talks about, but he doesn't really explain how do you combine the who's and the what's into the who plus what composite.
Yeah.
Right? I was just going to say, so my previous, before I was employed by OCAD, I worked as a social systems designer for 3 years, and so your work is very interesting to me. And I'm torn, and I'm holding these two possibilities right now, which is it's a very uncomfortable place, but I'm interested in the space between kind of a pattern language being quite formal and possibly being not necessarily recognizing emergence and kind of all those beautiful organic things about systems, and the idea of being able to do systems level kind of support with a very formal framework, I think is very like ideal. Like, even just seeing that you have regime shift on your thing, I was thinking in my mind, I'm seeing a service design blueprint of how we normally would map out service design. I'm thinking, no one thinks at those levels. Like, those are two separate kind of areas of I would think of it as like a change management project and then a service design. If it might be incredible. But I also know, if I said to any of my friends who work in that field, oh, a pattern language, they'd be like, oh, well, that is not inclusive at all. That is like, you can't apply a pattern to something. I don't know if I'm being too simplistic around the language.
Can I jump in on that? I'm coming at it from a very, very different perspective, but when I hear the words generative in the field study that I'm working in, which is more learning, psychology, that type of stuff, when we talk about generative, it means changing things. Mm-hmm. And the alternative is adaption in the language of this research. And adaption is basically just sort of slow change, incremental change versus dynamic change, or there's a word I'm looking for that I'm forgetting. And it's almost like we have to look at these patterns as, when I go to school, I have to learn the Queen's English. But if I came from a culture where the language had been adapted or changed or evolved because of a variety of things, for example, in Jamaica, or where's the Patois, I think it is down there, or Louisiana French, right, where it really evolved and stuff. So it's almost like we need sort of like, or another really bad jumping analogy, it's like the King James Bible, whatever came before the King James Bible, and then sort of a new version. You know, they keep every
50 years or whatever, there seems to be a new Bible from what I understand. So it's kind of like, when they have a pattern language set, the formal piece, that's the adaption piece, the non-generative. But as some of this language changes, we almost need another deck of cards that allows us then to get into that generative state. But I don't think that's exactly fitting into the Alexander.
This is the issue. It's not about Alexander. It's about taking from that and trying to move forward with it. Because he's an architect. He builds buildings. And when I talk about the architecture conference, they're all architects. They all build, they're planning. They're doing all these types of things. So I don't have any problem with the work they're doing because in that domain. The problem I have is everyone else in every other domain who said, we're doing this Christopher Alexander thing. And I think you're missing something.
They're all following computer scientist, which did it wrong.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
So
yeah.
We should be following you because you're developed it more directly from you. You really, you read everything Christopher Alexander wrote. If I'm just about.
No.
You went pretty far out there.
Yeah.
It's so, we can assume that streetcar rail was the wrong rail, and that was there for so long, and now everybody's building around that rail.
Is it the left rail or the right rail?
That's a permaculture problem. That's permaculture. That's making the best of the land.
And the oil spill. Do you see the oil spill? Asphalt.
It's on the asphalt.
Yeah. Asphalt is oil
spill. You talk about wayfaring. So is that like sense making, but all grounded?
No.
I'm sorry, say that again.
We saw Matt Wayfair.
That is Tim Ingold's stuff. And so the metaphor he has is about I forgot what you call it now. It's around a maze, and it's not a maze. The other one.
Labyrinth.
Labyrinth, yes, maze versus labyrinth. The thing about wayfaring is that when you go into the labyrinth, a labyrinth has one way in and one way out. It's not a maze that you get lost in. But the idea that you go into the labyrinth and you end up looking at the walls and it's like, wow, this is so great, and you end up just losing yourself there. The idea behind wayfaring is that you're in continuous connection with the world, and so you may have the intention that you're going to walk straight to school, but you don't do that because all of a sudden it's like, oh, there's a butterfly and I never noticed that butterfly before, and that's not wrong, that's part of human nature, but if you take the intentionality view, you miss on the wayfaring. So there's a lot, one article that Tim Ingold write is about differentiating between types of learning or approaches to learning and teaching, and one is about transmitting representations, and the other is about educating attention. And so normally when I give a lecture, and I'll probably do this on March 7th and 8th, is I say, everything I'm going to say in front of the lecture, in front of the students, you could read in a book. So why am I here if you could read everything in the book already? Like Wikipedia already has all the books are there. It's because I'm focusing your attention. I say, pay attention to this, don't pay attention to that. So all this Christopher Alexander stuff has been 50 years of writing, pay attention to this, which is really great stuff, but you need to understand that Alexander was a scientist and he wrote what he knew at a certain point in time. So in 1977, he said, I've got this one figured out, I'm gonna write a book on it. And then he writes about nature of order, publishes that, and that's the way he worked. So going back to the first thing he wrote and taking that as the Bible, which is a lot of people do, they take that as a Bible, that's a mistake. So wayfaring is saying, well, I'm not so focused on the book. Let's actually roam around Christopher Alexander's writing and read multiple books. Let's pick a chapter out here and just go, how does that fit with the idea over here? And like, is he being inconsistent or did he learn something? You only get it by wandering around.
So it's not sense making.
I think sense making is included in that. Like to me, what you just described sounds like experimentation, curiosity, cross-functional learning. Like there's a whole bunch of different things that you've described, and to me, sense making is a huge part of that.
I'll refer you to specific.
Sense making is more intentional. Wayfaring is sort of more
catch-as-catch-can kind of thing. Like, yeah. You know, if a butterfly, there's no butterfly going to cross my path today. So there's, you know, it's not like I can intentionally go find my butterfly. I have to wait a little. Well, maybe I can find a fake one somewhere.
Yeah,
Michael's gift store is close by.
And you run to Brenda Durbin and say the sense making is seeking help. I mean, you can think of help seeking to accomplish something of a situation. Mm-hmm. And so as her theory was, you know, to use questions like humble inquiry to tease out what, to help people, don't try to anticipate what they're trying to say, really tease out what their situation is, and that's helping them with their sense-making process. So that might, maybe more way-finding than way-faring for sense-making, which is help giving signposts.
That's a really good.
And way, because that's
no, 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 actually, in Gold is quite specific about it, because there's a whole section on way-finding and why it's not way-finding.
Yeah.
So it is way-faring.
You're getting somewhere. You're trying to get somewhere with way-finding.
Yeah.
They're helping you get somewhere through signposting and contextual clues.
That's a great
description of wayfaring.
Yeah, because Ingold would say when you're walking, you're wayfaring because and you don't think about it because the pavement is not flat. And you don't seem to fall when you walk down the street, when, even if the pavement is gone. So that's wayfaring because you're actually observing, you're trying not to fall on the street, but you just don't think about it.
It's just one thing you might, there's some new work around radical embodied cognition.
Oh, yeah.
It fits in with.
Yeah, no, this is in that ballpark.
Yeah,
it's all in that,
so
yeah.
That's opening up.
Tamaro stuff, yeah.
Well, actually, Friston's work, Carl Friston, and active inference and free energy principle, and he's actually the most cited neuroscientist for the last 10 years. He's actually been cited 200,000 times. Mm. It's completely regenerating the whole of how this stuff works. So you might want to, I'm looking into that quite a lot at the moment.
Yeah. I think it's in the same ballpark.
Yeah.
Okay, I think that we're wound down, so where are we going today for dinner, if anyone wants to go to Queen Street? Has anyone been to General Assembly?
Yes.
Is it good?
The big food hall?
No, it's just down here, it's a pizza place.
Oh, but then I'm thinking somewhere different.
No, I'm thinking about trying someplace different. So we'll figure someplace out, so whoever wants to come, we'll figure someplace out.
So we'll just wayfare our way over?
Yes.
No, it's been a little more intentional, whatever.